Hey, Delilah, I done got arrested by the boys. Can you buy me some bail? And I ain't gonna lie, can you get me just out of jail? I'm not a snitch, I'll never tell. I'll never tell. Oh, can you bail me out? 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 Can you bail me out?
Black Hebrew Israelites claim that Samson was a black man who had dreadlocks which gave him power and strength. But they clearly lack awareness of the root terms used in translations of the verses they use. Nor are they aware of the fact that numerous Indo-European and Mediterranean tribes had braided and dreadlocked their hair for thousands of years. Therefore proving that even if Samson had locks in the way they claim he did, this does not prove that he was a sub-Saharan African. I will also show how the exact same European tribes who did have braids and locks descended from the tribe of Dan, just like Samson. But let's start with the actual term translated as locks within scripture, because observing the root words actually muddies the water and shows that Nazarites certainly could have had free-form dreadlocks, but more often did not. Now, in order to understand what Samson would have looked like, let's start by explaining why Samson had long locks of hair. Before Samson was born, Israel had gone through a period of sin and disobedience. As a punishment, Yahweh subjected them to 40 years of submission and oppression at the hands of the Philistines. Samson's story begins in Judges 13, verse 2. Where we are told that there was a certain man from Zorah of the family of the Danites, whose name was Manoah, and his wife was barren and bare not. Now the fact that Samson was a Danite will become very significant later on in this video. But to carry on, verse 3 tells us that an angel of the Lord appeared unto the woman, and said to her, "Behold now, thou art barren and bearest not, but thou shalt conceive and bear a son." She was instructed and warned not to drink wine nor strong drink, and eat not any unclean thing, for she would conceive and bear a son, and no razor shall come upon his head. For the child shall be a Nazarite unto God from the womb, and he shall begin to deliver Israel out of the hand of the Philistines. So she brought this message to her husband and explained that this angel told her that she shall conceive and bear a son, and the child shall be a Nazarite to God, from the womb to the day of his death. Now first of all, a Nazarite is not the same as a Nazarene. Nazarene is somebody from Nazareth, where Yeshua was from. A Nazarite was one who took a vow to separate themselves to the Lord. And the law of a Nazarite states, when either a man or woman consecrates an offering to take a vow of a Nazarite to separate himself to the Lord, he shall separate himself from wine and similar drink. He shall drink neither vinegar made from wine nor vinegar made from similar drink. Neither shall he drink any grape juice nor eat fresh grapes or raisins. All the days of his separation, he shall eat nothing that is produced by the grapevine from seed to skin. All the days of the vow of his separation, no razor shall come upon his head, until the days are fulfilled for which he separated himself to the Lord, he shall be holy. Then he shall let the locks of the hair of his head grow. All the days that he separates himself to the Lord, he shall not go near a dead body. He shall not make himself unclean, even for his father or his mother, for his brother or his sister, when they die, because his separation to God is on his head. All the days of his separation, he shall be holy to the Lord. The verse of focus is Numbers 6 verse 5, where the Nazarite vow instructs him to let the locks of his hair grow long. The term translated as locks is Strong's Hebrew 6545, perah, meaning long hair or locks that are disheveled. Well, what does it mean to be disheveled? Disheveled means untidy or disordered appearance. In other words, disheveled hair would be uncombed, unbraided, and unstyled. So Nazirites are essentially commanded to let their hair grow without any trimming or maintenance. Their hair was to grow freely, unaltered, and unshaven by a razor. But were these dreadlocks? Well, consider that almost all dreadlocks are formed into place and locked in, which is not a natural process, but rather a formation through human intervention. The many types of dreadlocks are as listed. None of these are in correspondence to the Nazirite vow, so the only type of dreadlocks they could have had are free-formed dreadlocks, which we will show in a bit are not exclusive to any race whatsoever. Also keep in mind that intentionally dreadlocked hair is twisted tightly and locked into place. These dreadlocks can only be washed from the outside, as the hair within the dread is not accessible, and since the lock is so tight, it's hard for water to make its way through. Therefore, the hair inside the dread may become unhealthy and die out. To add, intentionally twisted dreadlocks can also lead to weak and thinning hair, as well as traction alopecia, which is caused by the constant pulling of hair follicles. Now, the reason this is important is because at the end of a Nazirite vow, he or she is required to cut their hair and bring it as an offering to the Lord. Seeing that Yahweh requires all his offerings to be unblemished, why would he desire a wad or wads of dead, unclean, and unhealthy hair? Understand that free-form dreadlocks are much easier to wash out and keep clean and healthy, because the dreads aren't intentionally twisted into tight locks, and there is more space between the hair strands for the water to pass through. Keep in mind, the Nazirite vow does not prohibit them from washing their hair, and in accordance to the command in Leviticus 22 verse 20, they would have to offer clean hair to Yahweh. What the Nazirite vow commands is that their hair be disheveled, which does not equate to unclean. It's therefore more likely that the Nazirites would have free-form dreadlocks rather than tightly twisted dreadlocks or braids. All that said, it isn't even a certain fact that Samson's hair did turn into free-form dreadlocks, as the term used in Judges 16 when describing his hair is simply locks. In order to understand how these locks looked, we need to delve into both the English and Hebrew definitions of this term. In the English language, dating all the way back to the era in which the King James Version was written, the definition of locks has been a piece of a person's hair that coils or hangs together, whereas the term dreadlock came much later during the Rastafarian movement in the 18th century. Rastafarianism is centered around an Antichrist false messiah named Emperor Haile Selassie, and he was thought to be the one who would redeem all people of African descent and lead them to Zion. He also had a falsified lineage to King Solomon. And if you'd like to know how to actually trace Solomon's bloodline, I recommend you watch my video titled The Lineage of King Solomon and David, where I explained how they looked, how they had rhesus negative blood, and which symbolism in the modern day can identify your lineage to them. But back to the Rastafarians. Dreadlocks are defined as rope-like strands of hair formed by locking or braiding hair. This is not the same as the term translated as locks in the King James Bible. And what's even more important is what this English term locks is translated from. In the original scripture, the Hebrew term translated as locks is Strong's 4253, a ringlet of hair. And what's the Hebrew definition of a ringlet? A lock of hair hanging in a corkscrew-shaped curl. This actually aligns with the English translation of locks, which are long strands of curly hair, and since Samson had seven of them, we can discern that he had naturally forming bundles of hair due to curly ringlets that caught onto one another and clumped together. Now, many proponents of the Black Hebrew Israelite movement will claim that these ringlets of hair are not free-forming locks or simple ringlets as the term suggests, but rather braids. This claim is due to a term related to Strong's 4253, which is Strong's 2498. This term has numerous meanings, none of which explicitly indicate plaited or broidered hair. The numerous translations of Strong's 2498, Kalaf, are to slide by, to hasten away, to pass on, to spring up, to pierce or change, to abolish, to alter, to change, to cut off, to go forward, to grow up, to be over, to pass away on or through, to renew, to sprout, and to strike through. Now, there are numerous problems with the suggestion that any of these indicate braids. For one, there is no explicit mention of this term meaning braided or woven hair, and it is actually used in numerous other verses that have nothing to do with hair at all. Furthermore, all of these terms can apply to curly hair that is not in the form of braids or dreads. For example, ringlets of hair will overlap and strike through or slide by one another, therefore getting tangled. Ringlets of hair pierce and pass over each other as well. Third of all, the term used in Judges 16 isn't even Strong's 2498, but simply a term related to it. And the actual term, as we went over, is ringlets of hair. Braided hair is not in the form of ringlets. And again, braids have to be intentionally styled, as they are a fashion trend. This again is in direct violation of the Nazirite law, which requires their hair to be unaltered and disheveled. A sister on YouTube named Adrienne Pyle puts it perfectly. She said, "The Nazirites were not allowed to do anything that glorified their human form. It was all about pushing down their ego and honoring what's holy. People today think it's holy to look good and clean and perfect, and to spend an hour on their hair or their face with makeup. That's the opposite of giving glory to God. God does not chastise you for not doing your hair or not putting on makeup. It's actually the opposite. He blesses you for not caring about these egotistical things. He blesses you for wanting to be holy and not just satisfying your outward appearance. This shows that you don't care what people think of you. It shows you don't care about being complimented on your appearance." She is absolutely right. It was actually the fallen angels who taught women how to braid their hair and put on makeup, all in order to seduce men and perpetuate promiscuity, therefore degenerating society. When we were in Eden, there was no such thing as combing hair or trying to look all pretty in order to get some action. Now, everything I've gone over thus far hints that Samson's hair naturally formed into clumps of locked hair due to its curly nature. And this is in accordance with his Nazirite vow. To add, this practice of letting the hair grow out naturally and untampered with actually parallels practices from numerous other religious sects throughout the East. For example, the sadhus in India will go out into the wilderness for about 30 years and allow their hair to grow out untamed, resulting in clumped locks of hair which more often than not turn into free-form dreadlocks. This is similar to how the Celts form their locks. In European folklore, fairy locks or elf locks are the result of fairies tangling and knotting the hairs of sleeping children and the manes of beasts, as the fairies play in and out of their hair at night. Essentially, fairy locks are natural locks which formed after people with long hair would sleep. The hairs would ultimately twist into one another and result in long, free-formed dreadlocks. Attributing it to fairies was just a method of mysticizing and adding spiritual pedigree to these locks. The concept of fairy locks is first attested to in literature, such as Shakespeare's Romeo and Juliet, written in 1595. Mercutio's speech of the many exploits of Queen Mab seems to imply that the locks are only unlucky if combed out. Mercutio says, "She is the fairy's midwife, and she comes in shape no bigger than an agate stone, She plaits the manes of the horses in the night and bakes the elf locks in foul, sluttish hairs, which once untangled, much misfortune bodes. Ultimately, these locks were to be kept disheveled, or else spiritual destitute would fall upon them. Shakespeare also mentions the fairy locks in the playwright King Lear, in which Edgar elfs all his hair into locks. In Charlotte Bronte's 1847 novel titled Jane Eyre, Jane's description of the character Rochester describes him as having elf locks bristled out from beneath a white band. Now, as we know, the Celts carried quite a bit of descent from the tribe of Dan, which Samson himself was from. The Celts in Ireland and Britain especially, since they descended from the Tuatha De Danann, who were said to have been a beautiful, tall, well-built people with red hair and blue or green eyes. They were a seafaring tribe and were possibly related to the Greek Pelasgians, who were said to be born from the teeth of a cosmic serpent named Ophion. Well, as we know, Dan was a seafaring tribe who remained in ships, and his tribal symbols were the serpent, eagle, and judge scales. As we know, the coat of arms and flag for the four provinces of Ireland depict an eagle, a prominent Danite symbol. Now, on the note of serpents, History.com states, among the legends associated with St. Patrick is that he stood atop an Irish hillside and banned snakes from Ireland, prompting all serpents to slither away into the sea. In fact, research suggests snakes never occupied the Emerald Isle in the first place. There are no signs of snakes in the country's fossil record. So obviously, these weren't literal snakes, but likely symbolic of the tribe of Dan, and the story of Patrick exiling them to the sea is another tie back to their seafaring tradition. Obviously, many will say that this story is about the Druids, which is certainly possible, but I find these ties to Dan to be very compelling. Now, in this famous painting of the Tuatha De Danann, I find it interesting how there is a woman with a serpent crown, and on the right side, a serpent-eagle hybrid slithering on the ground. Again, two out of three of Dan's tribal emblems were the eagle and serpent, so it makes sense that the Tuatha De Danann are depicted beside an eagle-serpent hybrid. What's also interesting is that the Tuatha De Danann followed the trend of Danites being worshipped as gods, similarly to how Woden, or Odin, was deified by his descendants. This again ties into the prophecy of Dan being a serpent in the path, biting the horse's heel, causing its rider to fall back. One part of this is them leading Israelites to false idol worship and the deification of their lineage. But, to get back to the Celtic dreads, these fairy locks were not only common in the British Isles, but also in Germany and France, where they were mentioned in numerous historic documents and folklores. What's interesting about fairy locks being prominent amongst the Celts and Germans is that these were two demographics with high traces of red hair. Matter of fact, red hair was mentioned as being an integral trait amongst the Scythians, who we will get into in a bit. The reason I mention this is because studies show that redheads tend to have more coarse, frizzy, and curly hair than other Caucasians. Furthermore, it's a fact that the Semitic Israelites carried the red hair trait, as evident in King David, who was described as being Admoni with beautiful eyes. Admoni in Hebrew translates to red hair, and this is the same term attributed to Jacob's brother Esau, who came out covered in red hair. These are the only two instances of the term Admoni in all of Scripture, and it's therefore undeniable that this term refers to red hair. Now, if we want to corroborate this through archaeology, there are a few methods of doing so. But before I go into the examples, let me make it clear that there is only one verified depiction of an Israelite in all of history. This is the Black Obelisk of Shalmaneser III, which shows the Israelite King Jehu bowing to the Assyrians after delivering tribute. Of course, he has straight, long hair rather than dreadlocks, braids, or an afro. Obviously, we cannot discern his hair color since this is a stone relief. Regardless, this is a clear indication that Israelites were in fact Caucasian. But when looking at Rekhmire's tomb in Egypt, we can see depictions of people who dwelled in the Canaan/Syria region during the reign of Amenhotep II. They clearly have red hair, and some of them even have braids or dreadlocks. We can also look at the tomb of Menkheperesneb, who also served during the reign of Amenhotep II. Here we see a Syrian tribute with a red beard. And notice, it's not just the Syrians or Canaanites who are depicted this way, the Libyans are as well. In this picture, we see a depiction of Libyans, a Nubian, an Asiatic, and an Egyptian. The four on the left are all Libyans and have light brown to blondish beards with either braided hair or dreadlocks. The four on the left are the sons of Put, son of Ham. And the second from the far right is likely a Canaanite, Hittite, Amorite, or Ammonite. Nevertheless, they are all depicted as white. We can even fast forward in time to the Jewish synagogues from 100 BC to 400 AD, which contain many mosaics depicting Jews as redheads. Here are the Galilean Hukkok mosaics, depicting Levite high priests, all of which having red hair and many having curly locks and ringlets of hair. Here's another picture from there. Then we have the Beit Alpha mosaics, which depict blonde, curly-haired individuals all over the place. Here is the Hamat Tiberias mosaic, which shows a white-skinned, red-haired man with curly hair holding the Danite judge scales. Interesting. Lastly, we have the Sepphoris mosaics, again showing a red-haired man with curly hair holding the Danite judge scales. Here's another mosaic depicting the binding of Isaac, in which both Abraham and Isaac are depicted as white-skinned men, one having brown hair and another having reddish-brown hair. Now guess what? We actually have two mosaics depicting Samson himself. And though they aren't indicative of how he actually looked, they do show us how the Jews believed him to look, which would obviously be based off how they themselves looked. The first was found at Hukkok Galilee, and depicts Samson carrying the gates of Gaza. In this picture, he has curly brown hair and prominent blue eyes. And the second is a massive letdown, because it only shows his legs. Nonetheless, he has white skin, which entirely contradicts the claims from the Black Hebrew Israelites. Now consider this. Esau was a warrior. His offspring were warriors. King David was a warrior. And throughout history, redheads became known as a fiery-tempered, warrior-minded people. It would make sense that one of the greatest warriors in the Bible was a redhead. Something that will be solidified throughout this video. Now, on the note of red hair again, I myself have red hair, and it's always been very curly, especially my beard, which would literally form into dreads if I hadn't combed it. That said, it's not just red-haired Caucasians who have curly hair. People of any phenotype can have curly or coiled locks. For example, this blonde fellow has massive freeform dreadlocks, and he did not need to do a single thing in order for them to form that way. To drive home my point that white people can easily grow freeform dreadlocks, let me show you a short clip from a channel called The Infinite Cut.
This is something that takes practice and dedication. What are you dedicating to? What are you here for on this path? Okay, look at this. This has taken me 10 years to get these to how long they are right now. You see that? So this is not for everybody. You have no idea how many looks I get, what little kids pulling on their parents' arms saying, "Daddy, mommy, look at that," right? Look at this. All right, this is 10 years of having free-form, natural dreadlocks. You can still see my curly ends right there at the at the end of all my dreads. I had naturally curly hair, really thick hair. And slowly over time, this is what's called the neglect method. I completely neglected my hair. I was living the path of the yogi in the woods, right? Constantly meditating, doing my asana practice, and anchoring into that higher consciousness. And 6-7 years later, I got these dreadlocks. This is what happens when they're locked up. You can see this one right here even is like two locks together that are stuck together like this, right? So I didn't go to the salon, right? I didn't go tell somebody I want this specific hairstyle and this is like maintaining my hair. I don't wake up in the morning and just do a hairstyle or anything like that. This is the path of enlightenment, the path of self-realization, okay? This has taken me 10 years to have these full natural dreadlocks. And I want to mention, I get a lot of comments from people like, "Oh, how do I start my dreads? What do I do? What do I do?" And guess what? You don't need to do anything, right? This is going to happen 100% naturally if you just let your hair grow, right? This is something that has taken me, like I said, about 10, almost 11 years now to have them this long. And they weren't always like this. Like, this is something that it's taken a lot of dedication because you have to get past what's called the awkward phase, right? You get past that and you are really going to have the dreadlocks that you want. So take your time. This have to be very patient, okay? So many people ask me about mold. "Oh, you should wash your hair, blah, blah, blah." I have very clean dreadlocks. They smell amazing. Oh, they just, you know, I use very natural products. I don't have any goos, no waxes, nothing like that. Natural is the way to go. Don't use any waxes. Don't use any goos. This is what's called free form dreadlocks. I didn't sit there with a crochet hook or anything like that. If you let your hair grow, it will lock up naturally. And this right here is what my hair used to look like. Let's see if I can get it to focus. This is what my hair used to look like before, all right? See the before and after? Look at this, all right? That is what my hair used to look like before this, okay? This is from, I think, 2007. And I've been growing my hair a long time, okay? This is what it takes. This is like the only picture that I have that's actually in existence that really shows what I used to look like before having dreadlocks. This is like right before the awkward phase that I was telling you about. You got to get let your hair grow past like your shoulders and then it's just going to lock up naturally, especially if you have really thick hair like I do. That's really the secret, is once you have really nice thick hair, there's that more lint that I was telling you about. See, I have to get in here all the time and get these like little lint pockets out. Otherwise you see like these blue little specks of lint and stuff in my hair and it's just annoying, honestly. So I am constantly like pulling little pieces of lint out, or like honestly now that I live in Hawaii with the beach and there's little pieces of sand in here, this is not for everybody. This is definitely not going to be the hairstyle that most people are going to be after. Again, because you're abiding to the body. You're thinking about how can I please the body. Well, guess what? This body is temporary. This body is going to rid itself and go back into the earth. This is 100% natural. I think everybody on the planet had dreadlocks at one point in time, and that's just how I look at it. Think about the earth, right? Think about what we did before the invention of a comb or a mirror. This is what everybody's hair looked like.
Now, besides free-form dreadlocks, which would occur in nearly every single person if they grew out their hair and didn't comb it, we do need to delve into the possibility that the translation used in Judges 16 is correct, and that Samson did not have dreadlocks, but rather long ringlets of hair. The reason I bring this up is because we cannot know for certain that Samson's hair formed into dreadlocks, even though it's the most likely case. See, Samson seemingly broke numerous statutes given to both the Nazarites and Israel as a whole. For example, coming near dead bodies or hooking up with prostitutes. So when it says he had ringlets of hair, it's possible that he did take care of his hair and did not leave it disheveled or allow it to grow into free-formed locks, but rather combed it. If this is the case, these ringlets may have looked similar to the Jewish pale, which derived from the commandment in Leviticus 19 verse 27, you shall not round off the hair of your temples or mar the edges of your beard. Now, though this hairstyle was not based on a Nazarite vow, and Jews had two peyotes rather than seven, this is still a blatant example of how Caucasians could have long ringlets of hair. You can see it in self-acclaimed Jews from all over the world, despite the various ethnicities, complexions, and hair types amongst them. And just to prove to the Black Hebrew Israelites that white people could have ringlets of hair, I'm growing out a peyote. I'm just kidding, but seriously, I could if I wanted to. And with that said, keep in mind that Africans don't have natural ringlets of hair. Their hair is either coiled into an afro or twisted into dreadlocks. Even their freeform dreadlocks have to be parted into sections. But I can already hear people bringing up that the Afar people from Ethiopia and how their hair is in ringlets. Little do people know how much maintenance actually goes into that hairstyle, and how the Nazarite vow completely invalidates their ringlets as being similar to Samson's. Reason being, they use butter, ghee, and red ochre to style their hair, whereas the Nazarites did not use products, did not comb their hair, and did not style it into braids or locks. They simply let it grow out, become disheveled, and grow out long, possibly resulting in free-form dreadlocks. And keep in mind, this was also dependent on how long they took the Nazarite vow for. It could take numerous years to even form one lock, so people who would take it for a short period of time likely never developed free-form dreadlocks. So with everything I've said, this isn't at all to say that Israelites never braided their hair. I'm sure they did. However, this was almost definitely not the case for Samson, or any Nazarite for that matter. But, like always, I like to utilize the Black Hebrew Israelites' false interpretations and show how even if they were right, they're still wrong. What I mean by this is even if Samson had styled dreadlocks or braids, which he didn't, this doesn't prove he was black. In order to understand this, we need to know who Samson is, what tribe he comes from, and what becomes of his tribe after their dispersal from Israel. Samson was from the tribe of Dan, whose prophecy was that they would rule over their brothers as judges. The Hebrew term for a judge is a militaristic leader or commander who oversees politics. As we know, I've mentioned in numerous videos before, that the judge period of Israel post-captivity was fulfilled by Odin, ancestor of many Germanics, and that it wasn't until Zedekiah's lineage was wiped out that a Davidic scepter would arise out of the northern house of Israel. As we know, Danites also leave behind waypoints in locations they migrate to, by naming them after their forefather Dan. When the Danites were exiled, along with the rest of the northern house of Israel, they were sent beyond Babylon. Beyond Babylon is Greater Scythia, where we have numerous historical mentions of the Israelites dwelling. For example, Judean historian Josephus states that there are but two tribes in Asia and Europe subject to the Romans, while the 10 tribes are beyond the Euphrates till now, and are an immense multitude, not to be estimated by numbers. So after being sent beyond Babylon, as Acts 7 verse 43 states, the Israelites took numerous routes and migrations towards Europe. Many of them settled along the Siret River in Romania, near the Black Sea. The Siret River, called Sereth in Germanic, was the biblical location of Arzareth. And leaving this region, we have rivers such as the Danube, Don, Dnieper, and Dniester, all leading towards Germania and Scandinavia, which consists of Denmark, Sweden, and Norden, the original name of Norway. These are the prophesied traces of Dan's migrations, and along each of them, we see massive numbers of redheads. Now, I don't want to go too far into the tribe of Dan in this video, so I'll redirect you to my videos on Deuteronomy 28, 1 Timothy 1 verse 4, and Scythian Israelites, where I give much more information on how the Scythians and Germanics carry large portions of Danite descent. I also suggest you look into the video, Where Did the Tribe of Dan in the Bible Go? By Lion of Patmos, where he explains Dan's early migrations into Greece. The reason I bring this all up is because when we look at depictions of both Greeks and Scythians, we see that they both have either dreadlocks or braids. Observing ancient gold burial art from Scythian graves, we see clear depictions of Indo-European men with long hair and big beards. Here we see two Scythian men holding a pelt. The one on the right has prominent dreadlocks. Here's another depiction of a dreadlocked Scythian man, seemingly gathering milk from a cow. This is significant, because milk was a staple of the Israelites' diet. When they were exiting Egypt during the Exodus, the Lord even said to them that they would be entering a land flowing with milk and honey. What's of vital importance is that in Leviticus 20 verse 24, Yahweh says, "You shall inherit their land, and I will give it unto you to possess it, a land flowing with milk and honey. I am the Lord your God, which have separated you from other people." Now you can argue that they were separated from others in a whole bunch of ways, but notice how he says that he separated Israel immediately after speaking about milk, and how it's not even in a separate sentence. Well, are you aware that Africans, Asians, and indigenous are 75 to 95% lactose intolerant, with that number being closer to 100% in locations with pure descent and no Indo-European admixture, while people of Indo-European descent are less than 18% lactose intolerant, being closer to 10% in locations of pure Caucasian ancestry. Obviously, we have been separated and have depended on milk for millennia. One reason being that the Indo-Europeans from the J and R1b haplogroups were the first to domesticate cattle in Upper Mesopotamia. Obviously, they were both sons of Noah, who repopulated the earth with cattle after the flood. And to go further, I speculate that R1b is the lineage of Isaac, and if you go to my video titled Haplogroup R, the Abrahamic haplotype, I explain how R1b is the lineage responsible for the diffusion of red hair. If this is Isaac's bloodline, it explains how figures such as Esau and King David were Admoni, or in English, red-haired. Now, like I said earlier, the Scythians were universally described as red-haired, so when you look at ancient pieces of gold burial art, picture them as Caucasian men with red hair. Now, also remember that the Germans and Celts had large portions of ancestry deriving from the Scythians. While the Celts are more known for red hair than Germans, historian Tacitus described the Germanic tribes as having red hair with a golden element to it. Furthermore, the Romans described both the Celts and Germans as having snakes for hair. This is obviously because they braided and dreadlocked it. And this was especially prominent amongst the Celts, who revered the motif of knots and braids, which were extremely prominent in all their art. Now we can even look into ancient Greek statues and pottery, in which more than 50% of their depictions show men and women with dreadlocks or braids. In Greece, some of the earliest depictions of dreads date back to 3600 BC. Indeed, frescoes uncovered in Crete and in Thera both show individuals with long braided hairstyles. And a quick mention, you may be wondering how Greeks had such a high prevalence of braided hair, yet the Romans never described Greeks as having snakes for hair, just the Celts and Germans. This is because the braided hair in Greece was prevalent for centuries before Rome rose to prominence, And by the time Rome hit its peak and begun to encounter these barbarian tribes, the Greeks had started to cut their hair short. So it's essentially due to the periods in which these accounts were written, as well as the gradual progression of cultural norms. But let's tie these Greek locks into the topic of red hair. It is actually said that numerous Greek heroes had fiery locks. For example, it is said that ginger hair was admired in ancient Greece because it was associated with honor and courage. For example, Homer's Iliad describes Menelaus and Achilles, both heroes in ancient Greece, as redheads. Achilles is also described as being blonde on other occasions, so it's likely he had tawny colored hair with both red and blonde strands. And this would explain why Achilles' son, Neoptolemus, was also called Pyrrhus, meaning red, due to his red hair. He then became the progenitor of the ruling dynasty of the Molossians. Both Plutarch and Thucydides describe the Molossian royal clan as red-haired people. And this all sheds light on why Achilles is depicted with a prominent red beard and long red hair in ancient Greek pottery. Now, many will say that this is depicting a black African, which is completely false. This was simply a style of art at the time, in which the pots were painted black and the pictures were painted around the actual figures of focus. For more information on this, go to my video on the tribe of Judah, where I also explain how both the Spartans and Maccabees in Judea had been corresponding with one another, and both agreed that the Dorian Greeks were originally under the cloud with Moses during the Exodus. With that said, I'll probably still receive claims from people claiming the Greeks were black. And this is why I want to bring up my mother's results on my true ancestry, which prove she is of ancient Greek and Minoan descent. Not only that, but she descends from the Phoenicians, who were also heavily descended from Dan. I explained in my video on Ephraim being a cake unturned that the education system is keen on upholding the false narrative that Phoenicians were solely Canaanite, because this perpetuates the idea that self-acclaimed Jews are the Israelites, and that we are a bunch of Gentiles. I recommend you watch that video. For now, understand that my mother is a Caucasian of predominantly Greek descent, and both her parents have a reddish tint to their hair. Their families come from Chieti, Italy, said to have been founded by Achilles and named after his mother. But to move on, besides the Greeks, Scythians, Celts, and Germans, there is also a more contemporary trend of dreadlocked hair amongst Eastern European populations. This was the Polish plague. Larry Wolf, in his book Inventing Eastern Europe, mentions that in Poland, for about 1,000 years, some people wore the dreadlocked hairstyle of the Scythians. It seems this tradition had developed over time, to where the Polish would then intentionally dread their hair into one or multiple dreads. Zygmunt Gloger, in his Encyclopedia Staropolska, mentions that the Polish plait was worn as a hairstyle by people in the Pinsk and Masovia regions at the beginning of the 19th century. He used the term koltun zapuskony, which denotes artificial formation of locks. According to folklore studies today, the style was formed using liquids or wax. Among liquids, a mixture of wine and sugar was used for washing hair daily with water in which herbs were boiled. So, though these were not free-form dreadlocks, they seemingly originated from the Scythians who wore dreadlocks. And though they artificially formed them, this is yet more evidence that Europeans had dreadlocked their hair for centuries before the Rastafarians became prominent. So to recap everything and close out the video, Caucasians had dreadlocks too, and if Samson himself had dreadlocks, they were not intentionally twisted as a fashion trend, but freeform due to neglection. That said, Samson may have instead had long ringlets of hair which clumped together, but did not necessarily form into dreadlocks. Nevertheless, based off biblical descriptions of Israelites and what becomes of the Danites after being scattered or migrating off, it's highly likely that Samson had red hair. If you look into the many nations known for this trait today and see how they carry traces of Danite descent, carry Danite symbolism, and come from the exact regions in which Danites migrated or were dispersed to, it paints a clear picture. Just because Nazarites had long hair doesn't mean you should. Keep in mind 1 Corinthians 11 verse 14. Doth not even nature itself teach you that if a man have long hair, it is a shame unto him? But if a woman have long hair, it is a glory to her, for her hair is given her for a covering. In this case, nature is referring to social nature and the way society ran at the time. But however you want to spin it, Paul is clearly saying that it's a shame for men to have long hair, something the Corinthians in specific were known for. And on the note that men should have short hair and women long hair, notice the term translated as locks in Judges 16. It's a feminine noun. So Samson had hair like a woman, and the only reason he was allowed to was due to his Nazirite vow. Keep in mind that Nazir means consecrated or separated, and that's exactly what they were. They were making an effort to separate themselves in every way possible, even having long hair, which men were not supposed to. And this is how they were so easily identified in society. So unless you take a Nazirite vow and live in accordance to its laws, you are not to have long hair as a man. And if you do take up the mantle of a Nazirite, understand that it is a lifetime vow, as there is no temple for you to go to when you want to finish it. There is no tent of meeting for you to go to if you break one of the laws and defile yourself. So you are in a tricky situation. Of course, people will ask, what if the third temple is built? And this is a valid question because it's seemingly going to be built very soon. Considering the Jubilee and sabbatical cycles, the star signs, the end days prophecies being fulfilled, and now the five red heifers arriving in Israel, the construction of a third temple seems imminent. However, do you really want to go to a temple with Canaanite high priests, fake Kohens, and end your vow there, at the same place where the Antichrist will seat himself and declare to be your savior? I don't think so. And if you doubt that those self-acclaimed Kohens are Canaanite, keep in mind Zechariah 14 verse 21. Yes, every pot in Jerusalem and in Judah shall be holiness unto the Lord of hosts, and all that sacrifice shall come and take of them, and see therein. And in that day there shall be no more Canaanite in the house of the Lord of hosts. Well, what's the house of the Lord of hosts? That is the house of worship, the temple, which only the high priests are allowed into. I highly recommend you go to my video on the R haplogroup in order for a better understanding as to how the self-acclaimed Kohen modal haplotype, JYDNA, is actually Hamite. And last of all, I want to make it very clear that having long hair will not bring you strength or power. All of that came from the vow itself, and the intentional separation away from society unto Yahweh.